'cause I'm tired. Options are few. I'm trying to pray, but oh, where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't fake what's left to do. Truth is I'm weak, no strength to fight, no tears to cry. Even if I try, but still my soul refuses to die. One touch will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. Heart is torn to pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory and sing to you the song. Take me to the King. Stop playing these games. We need a word for the people's pain. So Lord, speak right now. Let it fall like rain. We're desperate. We're chasing after you.
Take Good evening, everyone, and welcome once again to our Thursday night virtual Bible study. I'm so glad that you would join us again tonight as we continue in a series that we began several weeks ago, and tonight we're going to be dealing with it again, part five of What Do You Really Believe? We're seeking to find out exactly what we believe. In order to do that, we've got to deal with what is suggested that we as Baptists ought to believe, but we're going to dig deeper later on to find out what you believe. That's the real question here. What do you really believe? It's not really about the articles of faith. The articles of faith, it's really what we should believe as Baptists. But we want to delve deeper and discover exactly what do you believe. You do know, just for the sake of a reminder, when we talk about articles of faith, it's not just a Baptist thing. All faiths, religions, denominations have articles of faith. These are what I'd like to call the common thread that runs between those who are associated with it. So you'll find out that there are many articles of faith. We have, over the past couple of weeks, been dealing with the articles of faith. We're dealing with Baptist articles of faith, and we've been taking a look at two sets of those articles of faith. One is the Southern Baptist Convention, and the other is the National Baptist Convention, USA Incorporated, the convention of which we are a part. So as we continue to take a look at these articles of faith, today we're going to look at the article that deals with man, or the fall of man, depending on which one you take a look at. And we're going to take a look at both of them, and I have help again tonight. So let's look at man. According to the Articles of Faith of the Southern Baptist Convention, they title it Man. And this is what they say. Man. Man is the special creation of God, made in his own image. He created them male and female as the crowning work of his creation. The gift of gender is thus part of the goodness of God's creation. In the beginning, man was innocent of sin and was endowed by his creator with freedom of choice. By his free choice, man sinned against God and brought sin into the human race. Through the temptation of Satan, man transgressed the command of God and fell from his original innocence, whereby his posterity inherited a nature and an environment inclined towards sin. Therefore, as soon as they are capable of moral action, they become transgressors and are under condemnation. Only the grace of God can bring man into his holy fellowship, enable man to fulfill the creative purpose of God. The sacredness of human personality is evident in that God created man in his own image, and in that Christ died for man. Therefore, every person of every race possesses full dignity and is worthy of respect and Christian love. Now that's the Southern Baptist Convention's Article 3, and it talks about man. We're then given scriptures. And as you will see, those scriptures are listed before you tonight. Take a look at those scriptures, jot them down, and remember, you can get a copy of these PowerPoints and get those scriptures so that you can read them for yourself. These are the supporting scriptures for their article of faith on man. Then there is the fall of man. This is the article, as it's entitled by the National Baptist Convention. The fall of man. We believe the scriptures teach that man was created in holiness under the law of his maker, but by voluntary transgression fell from that holy and happy state, in consequence of which all mankind are now sinners, not by constraint, but choice, being by nature utterly void of that holiness required by the law of God, positively inclined to evil, and therefore under just condemnation to eternal ruin without defense or excuse. Well, tonight, to help us to understand further this idea, this concept, this article of the fall of man, I have enlisted the support of another one of our candidates for ordination coming up real soon, and that is Minister Yolanda Waller Darden. Let's see what she has to say to us tonight.
Good evening, my brothers and sisters. This evening, our Thursday night Bible study focus is item number 3 within our Articles of Faith. It is entitled, The Fall of Man. Yes, The Fall of Man. Now let's get right to our study. It has already been established that the Articles of Faith, they are defined as follows. They are a summary statements of foundational beliefs held by individuals, churches, or ministries. They set forth the essential truths which guide every area of belief and practice. Sometimes articles of faith are also called or referred to as a doctrinal statement, a statement of faith, or a statement of belief. Within our articles of faith, the fall of man, as I've mentioned, is item number 3. Item number 3 in its entirety reads as thus in the articles of faith. We believe the scriptures teach that man was created in holiness under the law of his maker, but by voluntary transgressions fell from that holy and happy state. In consequence of which all mankind are now sinners, not by constraint, but by choice, being by nature utterly void of that holiness required by the law of God, positively inclined to evil, and therefore under just condemnation to eternal ruin without defense or excuse. We will dissect item number 3, section by section. The first part states that we believe scriptures teach that man was created in holiness under the law of his maker, but by voluntary transgressions fell from that holy and happy state. Now, if I were to paraphrase item 3 in our everyday vernacular or language, I would say it something like this. The Bible says that man was created without sin by his maker, God, in accordance with his law. Man made a choice, he sinned, and as a result, he was no longer sinless or without sin. So let's park right here just for a few moments. The we in this section, where it says, we believe the scriptures, that we refers to the baptized believers of Jesus Christ, the body of Christ, the church. Scripture refers to the entire counsel of God. Scripture means the Holy Bible, the holy book that contains the revelation of God to humanity or man, the holy writ, the canon of scripture, all 66 books, the 39 Old Testament books, and the 27 New Testament books. The Holy Bible or the scriptures teach us that man was in fact created in holiness in the image of God. Who is man that we refer to in our articles? Good question. Here's the answer. Man is human being and God is his maker. How do we know this? Scripture supports it. In a number of scriptures, and we'll just go through a few of them this evening. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. These verses read this way. And please note that we are using and referencing the New King James Version in each of our scriptural references this evening. And it reads as thus. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." Verse 27 reads, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them." Genesis 2 and 7, it reads this way. "God created man, male and female, from the dust of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Genesis 5, 1 and 2 says this. "He created man, both male and female." This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that God created man, in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them, and blessed them and called their name Adam in the day when they were created. As man was created in the image of God is the essential and primary definition of man. As man was made by God in his image, thus becoming an image bearer, he was then made in holiness, that is, without sin. Ecclesiastes 7 and 29 also tells us, "Lo, this only have I found, that God had made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions." The first man created, Adam, was created in holiness and innocence, in that before his fall, he had not yet personally experienced sin. He was not guilty of a crime or offense. Man was free from moral wrong. He was not corrupted. The next section of item 3 reads, "In consequence of which all mankind are now sinners, not by constraint, but choice, being by nature utterly void of that holiness required by the law of God, positively inclined to evil." Now, we're familiar with the first sin recorded in scripture, right? The story of Adam and Eve, and when Eve ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil after receiving specific instructions from God not to do so. The following scriptures provide a quick recap. Genesis chapter 2, verses 16 and verse 17. "And the Lord God commanded man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die." Genesis chapter 3, verse 6 reads, "So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate." Man, who was created in the image of God, made from the dust of the ground, who was made in holiness, which consisted of holiness and rationality, lost the full extent of this image when he sinned against God. It's important to note that a choice was made, that it was a choice. Man was not forced to sin, but he made a choice to sin. And choices do come with consequences. The consequence of sin was death, in every sense of the word, physically, spiritually, and eternally. Well, what was the result of that choice? Because of the sin of the first man, Adam, and the first woman, Eve, this sin committed by Adam and Eve was imputed to all of humanity. In other words, as a representative of humanity, we were all credited with the sins of one man. Romans 5 and 19 says it this way, "For as one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be made righteous." I'd like to read that again for emphasis. It's a very important verse. Romans 5 and 19. For as one man's disobedience, the disobedience of Adam and Eve, many were made sinners. You and I were made sinners. So that also by one man's obedience, Jesus Christ, many will be made righteous. So all of humanity will be made righteous by the obedience of Jesus Christ. We all became sinners because of Adam's fall, the sin of one man imputed to all of humanity. Man was made responsible for his sin or transgression because he became a free moral being. And there was a sentence pronounced. The sentence pronounced upon man as a result of this sin was death. Because of sin, man cannot be saved by law because man is utterly void of the holiness required by the law of God. My brothers and sisters, often people will say to you, there is good news and there is not so good news. And as I bring this teaching to a close on this evening on the Articles of Faith, item number 3, I'd like to start with the not so good news. Some people start with the good news, but this evening I'm going to start with the not so good news in the recap. The not so good news is that you and I, all of humanity, each and every one of us, we are void of the holiness required to meet the requirements of the laws of God. And when I say the laws of God, essentially I'm referring to Exodus chapter 20, verses 2 through 27, the Ten Commandments, the laws of God. We don't possess the holiness that's required. We have been impaired because of the sins of one man, because of the sins imputed to us, because of Adam and Eve in the garden and eating from the tree of knowledge. We don't possess the holiness required because of the sin nature that we have adopted. But the good news is salvation has been offered to us via the messianic promise of Jesus Christ. And thanks be to God, we have been reconciled to God because of the obedience of one man in Jesus Christ. So if salvation had not been offered through that messianic promise, if salvation had not come down through 42 generations through Jesus Christ, our condition would have been eternal death. It would have been death in a physical sense, a death in a spiritual sense, and a death in an eternal sense. It means that we would have been eternally separated from God and not had a path or a way to be reconciled back to God. But oh, thanks be to God, there is good news. The good news is that through Jesus Christ, through that messianic promise and Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection, we have eternal life and we've been delivered from the power and the penalty of sin. Man was created by God in his image in holiness. When man sinned, however, his image was impaired. The consequence of this sin was physical, spiritual, and eternal death, death in every sense of the word. This sin was imputed to you, to me, our children, our neighbors, everybody. Because of sin, man was made responsible for his sin and he became a free moral being. He had the ability then to make choices, the free will of man. And this sentence pronounced upon man because of the sin and the transgression, it was death. And at this time, man no longer possessed the holiness required to fulfill the law of God. It's important to note that we were made utterly void of the holiness required to fulfill the laws of God. No matter how good we have been or all of the good things that we do, we still have adopted, we have a sin nature. And no matter what we do, we have a sin nature because we inherited it from Adam and from Eve. But thanks be to God, our great God, he loved us so much, unconditional love, that he sent Jesus to die for our sins so that we could be reconciled back to him and have eternal life. That is the good news on this evening. And this concludes our teaching on the Articles of Faith, Item number 3, the fall of man. May God bless you.
Thank you so much, Minister Darden, for helping us to better understand and have a greater appreciation for the fall of man. Now, as we continue, there is a second segment we're going to look at tonight, and then we'll be done. We're going to look at salvation, or the way of salvation. And this is Article 4 of the Southern Baptist Convention. It says, salvation involves the redemption of the whole man and is offered freely to all who accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, who by his own blood obtained eternal redemption for the believer. In its broadest sense, salvation includes regeneration, justification, sanctification, and glorification. There is no salvation apart from personal faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. A, regeneration, or the new birth, is the work of God's grace whereby believers become new creatures in Christ Jesus. It is a change of heart wrought by the Holy Spirit through conviction of sin, to which the sinner responds in repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repentance and faith are inseparable experiences of grace. Repentance is a genuine turning from sin toward God. Faith is the acceptance of Jesus Christ and commitment of the entire personality to him as Lord and Savior. B, justification. Justification is God's gracious and full acquittal upon principles of his righteousness of all sinners who repent and believe in Christ. Justification brings the believer unto a relationship of peace and favor with God. C, sanctification. Sanctification is the experience, beginning in regeneration, by which the believer is set apart to God's purposes and is enabled to progress towards moral and spiritual maturity through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit dwelling in him. Growth in grace should continue throughout the regenerate person's life. D, glorification. Glorification is the culmination of salvation and is the final blessed and abiding state of the redeemed. You'll see now scriptures that support this article as noted by the Southern Baptist Convention. Please take a look at those scriptures. Again, you can get a copy of these notes, and we'll tell you how to do that at the end of this presentation. Now, there is the Article of Faith number 4 of the National Baptist Convention, the Way of Salvation. It says, we believe that the scriptures teach that the salvation of sinners is wholly of grace through the mediatorial offices of the Son of God, who by the appointment of the Father freely took upon him our nature, yet without sin, honored the divine law by his personal obedience, and by his death made a full atonement for our sins, that having risen from the dead, he is now enthroned in heaven and uniting in his wonderful person the tenderest sympathies with the divine perfection. He is in every way qualified to be a suitable, a compassionate, and an all-sufficient Savior. Well, I got some help with this tonight. Another one of our ordinands is going to share some additional information, and that is Dr. Robin Sessom. She's going to share with us tonight. Dr. Poole, share with us now.
What is salvation? Who needs salvation and why? How do we get saved? What happens if we don't get saved? How is your salvation secured, and what was necessary to secure your salvation? These questions I will address as we discuss the truth about salvation and what we believe as Baptists. Previously, you've heard about the true God and the fall of man. Of course, God was not surprised about the fall, for it was foreknown by God. But the fall of man required a response from God, and that response was salvation. The study of salvation is known as soteriology. Salvation concerns an internal spiritual deliverance from God's judgment of sin. It is deliverance from the power and penalty of sin. A sinner is one who has committed an immoral act against God's divine law. The reality is every human being is a sinner, and every sinner needs salvation. The scriptures teach us in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And in 1 John 3:4, the Bible says, "Whoever commits lawlessness and sin is lawlessness." That's why we need to be saved, because the lawlessness, which is sin, brings forth a death sentence. The Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death." That is, death in every sense, physically, spiritually, and eternally. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yes, salvation, it is a gift. It is the gift of God by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. We can't earn it. We can't work for it. In fact, we don't even deserve it. Salvation is the unmerited gift of God. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." It is important then to realize that sin separates us from God. In fact, our sins are debts to God. And because humanity was not able to pay the sin debt owed to God, God willingly paid the sin debt, wipe our slates clean, and accomplish our need for salvation by providing a Savior through Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. Have you ever wondered how salvation begins? It begins when we are convicted of our sins. When we are convicted of our sins, we repent. Now, I'm going to give this one to you for free. To repent means to express sincere regret or remorse about one's wrongdoing or sin. And faith and repentance are both necessary for salvation. In fact, without faith and repentance, salvation is impossible. Faith and repentance lead to true conversion. And when we experience true conversion, we are changed, moving from carnal to spiritual. How is that so? Good question. It's called regeneration. And regeneration involves a change of the mind, in which God and God alone imparts new spiritual life to us. The mind is affected in a manner which is beyond our comprehension. True conversion, on the other hand, is a change of the heart because of regeneration. God regenerates our mind and humanity reacts. You've heard the term to be born again. In John 3:5, Jesus answered, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." True conversion is being convicted of sins enough to repent in response to the gospel. One cannot call on the name of the Lord to be saved if one does not hear the gospel. It is written in Mark 1:15, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Once you are saved, you are always saved. Let me say that again. You cannot lose your salvation once you are saved. Now, here's something to think about. Is there only one way to be saved? The Baptists believe there is only one way to be saved. That way is by eternal life offered through God's Son, Jesus Christ. Do you need evidence? Do you need some proof? The Bible says in Acts 4:10-12, "Let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man stands here before you whole." Verse 12, "Nor is there salvation," here it is, "in any other, for there is no other name under heaven among men by which we must be saved." And Jesus said in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Salvation therefore comes to the sinner, that's you and I, through the mediatorial offices of Jesus the Christ, the Son of God. The mediatorial offices of the Son of God are Jesus the prophet, Jesus the priest, and Jesus the king. Jesus the prophet is one who speaks forth for God. In Matthew 21:11, the scriptures say, "This is Jesus the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee." Jesus the priest is one who offers sacrifices. Hebrews 10:12 says, "But this man," meaning Jesus, "after he offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down at the right hand of God." And Jesus, the king who rules. In John 18:37, it is written, "Pilate therefore said to him, 'Are you a king then?' Jesus answered, 'You say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth." Okay, salvation comes to the sinner through the mediatorial offices of Jesus Christ as prophet, priest, and king. But what did Jesus Christ have to do to secure our salvation? Christ had to die to make atonement. Atonement is satisfaction rendered to the law for some injury. That injury was our sin debt. Humanity could not be saved by the law because humanity was utterly void of the holiness required by the law of God. So in 1 John 2:2, the Bible says, "He himself," meaning Jesus, "is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world." But what makes Jesus Christ an all-sufficient Savior? Jesus Christ is an all-sufficient Savior because he is in every way qualified to be Savior, and he possesses all of the qualifications necessary for salvation. Those qualifications are power, wisdom, holiness, mercy, justice, truth, and immutability, which means unchangeable. 2 Corinthians 2:19 says, "And he," meaning Jesus, "said to Paul, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Okay, we've talked about what salvation is, who needs salvation, and why. We've covered what happens if you don't get saved, and what was necessary for Christ to secure our salvation. But the question still remains, what must we do to be saved? It's what I call the ABCs of salvation. Admit, believe, confess. First, we must A, admit that we are sinners and that sin separates us from God. God will not overlook sin. The Bible says in Isaiah 59:2, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. When we realize and admit that we are sinners, we must repent for our sins. Repentance involves three things. First, we must be sorry for what we have done against God. In 2 Corinthians 7:10, the Bible says, for godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death. We repent because we should hate sin as much as God hates sin. Second, B is for believe. We must believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Acts 16:31 in the Bible tells us to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved and your household. Simply put, we must believe in the death, the burial, and resurrection of the blessed Christ. Third, we must see, confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Romans 10:9-10 says that if we confess with our mouth the Lord and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Admit, believe, and confess. You are saved. And now that you are saved, what is next? You get baptized. When a believer is baptized, they surrender their life in faith and obedience to God. And God, by the merits of Christ's blood, cleanses one from sin and truly changes the heart and the state of the person from sinner to citizen in God's kingdom. Only the blood of Christ can wash away sins. In Mark 16:16, the Bible says, he who believes and is baptized will be saved. Two, pray every day and consecrate yourselves to the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And in Romans 12:1, the Bible says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, accountable, and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Three, after baptism and the discipline of daily prayer and consecrating yourselves to the Lord, I encourage you to unite in fellowship with a Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching church. Our example is modeled in the early church in Acts 2:41-42. Then those who gladly received his word, that is the gospel, were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayer. Finally, we all should desire that others be saved. In fact, Jesus commands us in the Gospel of Matthew 28:19-20. It's the Great Commission. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Well, there you have it. The truth about salvation and what we believe as Baptists. But I want you to hear me and hear me good with your good ear. Nothing prevents the salvation of the greatest sinner on earth but their own depravity and voluntary rejection of the gospel. My sisters, my brothers, it is my prayer that you take your salvation seriously and live a life that is lived by faith in a moment-to-moment surrender to God. Live a life that is lived in triumph over everything in this world. Victorious Christian life is your life. It is my life. It is a journey of faith, not just for eternal salvation, but of daily decisions, building up into a lifestyle, since we have been saved and delivered from the power and penalty of sin. We are saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. Live victoriously in the name of Jesus, the blessed Christ. Be blessed.
Again, thank you, Dr. Poole, and thank you, Minister Darden. You've been of great help tonight, and I pray that those of you who've been listening have a better understanding of the articles of faith, particularly those that give our attention to man, or fall of man, salvation, or the way of salvation. Well, it's time to go. No homework tonight. Again, if you'd like a copy of the slides, all you have to do is email your request to executiveassistant@mountzionbaptist.com and you'll get a copy. Until we get to meet again, God bless you. Enjoy the rest of your week, and I look forward to sharing with you again. God bless you, and good night.
Amen. We thank God for his blessed word today. We were blessed today, and we pray that you will remain with us for a very important part of this service. That is the invitation to discipleship. If you are unsaved, this is an opportunity for you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Brothers and sisters, God allowed his only begotten Son to die a painful death so that we might have eternal life. My friend, you do not want to live in this world without Jesus Christ. It is absolutely essential that you accept him as your Savior right now, today. You can do that wherever you are. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 10 in the New International Version, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. If you are not saved and would like to be, all you have to do is pray the following prayer with me. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you admitting that we are sinners. Right now, we choose to turn away from sin, and we ask you to cleanse us with your blood of all unrighteousness. We believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, died on the cross to take away our sins, and we believe that he rose again from the dead so that we might be justified and made righteous through faith in him. And so we call on the name of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we declare right now that we are born again children of God. We are free from sin and full of the righteousness of God. We are saved in Jesus' name. We choose to follow you, and we ask that you will fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, please be assured that you are saved. If you prayed that prayer with me, please give us a call at 703-979-7411. Or send us an email at info@mountzionbaptist.com so that we can welcome you to the body of Jesus Christ. Once again, that number is 703-979-7411, or you can email us at info@mountzionbaptist.com. When you contact us, we will direct you to someone who will assist you with whatever questions you may have about this wonderful gift of salvation. They will gladly answer also any questions that you may have about joining us here at Mount Zion. If you are saved and presently without a church home and are interested in uniting with us here at Mount Zion Baptist Church, please give us a call at 703-979-7411 or email us at info@mountzionbaptist.com. We would be more than glad to walk you through the process of becoming a member of Mount Zion Baptist Church. Amen, amen, peace and blessings to you. Amen. God bless you. It's offering time. If there's any time that we get excited at Mount Zion, it's at offering time. We get excited at offering time because we know that the Lord loves a cheerful giver. We know that due to our inability to gather, that we can't do offering in the traditional way. But we invite you to take advantage of the opportunity to give. There are four ways to give to Mount Zion. First, you may give using the Easy Tithe app on your smart device or your cell phone. You can easily download the app to your smart device to give. Secondly, you may also text to give via the Easy Tithe app by dialing 703-372-9244. Once again, that number is 703-372-9244, and you can utilize that number to text to give. Thirdly, you may also give by visiting our website. The website is mountzionbaptist.com. Once you're at that website, you can click on online giving and then click on the Easy Tithe logo to give. Once again, that website is mountzionbaptist.com. Click on online giving and then click on the Easy Tithe logo to give. And then lastly, you may give by mailing your gift to the address that presently appears on the screen. Please know that any way that you choose to bless us, we will be satisfied. Kingdom work continues even though we cannot meet in a traditional manner. Please know that we're grateful for your continued support. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for the monies that was collected today. We thank you, God, for your kindness, your mercy, and your grace. We pray, God, that the money collected today will be used for the uplifting in your kingdom. Please, Father, give us the wisdom to do so. We pray, God, for all those who are entrusting you by continuing to be stewards of all those things that you have blessed them with. We pray, God, that they will lose nothing for their giving, that even during this pandemic, you will bless them not only monetarily, but emotionally, physically, and spiritually. These things, Father, we ask for, and these things, Father, we say thank you for. In the name of your darling son, Jesus Christ, amen. May God bless each and every one of you. And once again, we thank you for your continued support. Amen.
Jehovah.